Hello everyone and welcome back to another review video. My name is Alexander and today we're looking at one of my friends Ford Fiesta ST Mark 8, a very good looking and affordable hot hatch for younger people especially. So this being the Mark 8 means that we have a 1.5 liter three-cylinder turbocharged engine with about 200 horsepower and 290 newton meters of torque, with a curb weight around 1300 kilograms, and of course six-speed manual transmission, front-wheel drive, and the three-cylinder engine, despite many people believing that it runs unsmoothly, this being a very modern engine and runs very smooth and has a really, really nice power band. So let's talk about the exterior. It looks of course very good, a lot better than the Mark 7 Fiesta STI or even the normal Fiesta. Looks really, really nice with this metallic blue color and looks pretty aggressive actually. If you have it behind you in the rearview mirror, this is a very nice aggressive look. Now the front headlights look very nice, full LED. We have daytime running lights here across the outside, which look really good when they're on. And we have here on the inside this little strip, dynamic blinkers that move from here, from the inside to the outside. Looks really, really good. Now we have here the Maxton design front splitter for a little tasteful enhancement here at the front. Looks really nice. Further down here we have the 18-inch rims. These are very small hot hatch like rims. They're very playful, you know, they're not straightforward, just a couple of spoke designs where I have here like five double spokes or anything like that. So this is, you know, it's five spokes where they are like divided into these check marks here and stuff. So it looks really, really, really interesting. Now here on the side also this one having custom side skirts installed from the same manufacturer as in the front and everywhere else here, which we will come to, makes the car look a lot, or at least a little bit wider, really pops out like that. Coming here to the rear, we have the rear taillights, which are horizontal instead of vertical, like in more older cars like the Mark 7. Which looks better. I think if you make any car horizontal, taillights look a lot better than vertical ones, maybe with some exceptions in some maybe more exotic cars or stuff like that, but in general it's the horizontals is better. Now like in the front and on the side we have also here a new part, a diffuser that he installed. Looks very good, gives the rear a nice beefy look to it, especially of course with these big Miltech sports exhausts. These big, big pipes almost can fit my fist into there, but makes the car of course a lot louder and adds a lot of pops and bangs, even in low RPMs, which is really, really nice. And here on top, we have a spoiler lip, which is not staying on for a lot longer. He is not very pleased with the looks in person, how it looks in person. So he will be removing it. And instead, I think he will be installing some sort of spoiler raiser where the normal spoiler that is on here is being raised and departed further to the back to make it look beefier. So moving to the rear. Now One negative point that the owner had to say about the cargo space is that the loading sill is pretty high up. So if you're carrying something and you want to lift it up and put it inside, you have to lift it up pretty high. So that's a point of complaint. But in general, even for a small hot hatch, in his opinion, there's plenty of space, as he told me, as long as you can fit a couple of crates of beer into the back of your car, there's plenty of space in there. So no worries there. Underneath you have the subwoofer and also sound generator, and of course, you know, repair kits and stuff like that, compressor, no spare wheel. But yeah, here's where the sound generator magic happens, in the back. So moving along, this, if you have not noticed yet, is a three door, which means if you want to get into the back, you have to pull a lever here, fold the seat forwards and move it forwards. Now let's get inside. As you can see, five seater, three seats in the back. Sit down, take the seat and pull it back. Now, as you can see, the space is a bit confined. There's not much space, especially if you're big. I am 170 centimeters tall and my legs are pretty short. So if you're somewhere above that, this might be a bit more uncomfortable. Maybe the person here in the front might wants to move the seat forwards a little bit for you to have more space, but in general, no, a bit crampy. But I think for short distance driving, you know, just like 50 kilometers or something like that, just from one small town to another nearby, not that big a deal. And to sit more comfortably, you can and maybe sit like this, because you have these thicker parts here and you have a little bit like indent in the seats here for a little bit more leg space, or you go into man spreading mode and spread them like this. But yeah, in general, not that much space. Head space is all right. Like I said, 170 centimeters am I, and this is how much space I have up there. Like four fingers, let's say. So yeah, it's all right. Now let's take a look at the dashboard, all of this place. All in all, in general, it looks really nice. Everything is tidy, you know, you have all your, the infotainment system here, you have all your air conditioning controls over there, some places to put things and stuff like that. Nothing out of order, really. Of course, plastic, hard plastic and stuff, like in every car of a certain price range like that, but overall it's all right. I like the slanted air ducts here on the sides. I think they look nice, they give like a nice design feature. What I do not like, and this is really nitpicky, I guess, but you know, you see this carbon finish. I don't know if you can see the carbon fiber in there. You know, a sort of carbon fiber finish, these trims that they have. I don't know why they didn't pull these together. Like, I don't like this gap that's coming out of here. I guess it's to keep maybe this part in one piece, to not make a separate part. But even then, there's on the outside, I guess. But yeah, this is a little nitpicky design thing that I have that I don't like. Aside from that, the door handles, these bits over there and over there, are pretty low quality. As the owner said, they if you grab them and you know, grab a little harder, they creak and squeak, so you can hear that they're not really from nice materials. You know, it's all also plastic and stuff, but the way they're built is not very high quality, so not very good on that. One other thing is the drive mode here at the bottom. And that's the problem. It is at the bottom and not like on the steering wheel where it should belong, or at least somewhere up here on the top in better reach and in within visibility of the driver. It's down here, and of course you can feel it and stuff, but in a sports oriented car, I think these kinds of buttons belong somewhere in better reach, I would say. Mechanical handbrake, very good. Leather finish, feels really nice. Better than you could say in the i30N, which is quite a bit more expensive. That handbrake is a lot thinner in the first place. This is pretty thick, I guess because of the leather coating. And it's from hard plastic like that, so not very nice. So this is a lot better for even cheaper money. But overall, really nothing you can complain about. Looks, of course, better than in the Mark 7, like a lot of things do. But I think that's just moving with the times. All right, let's move to the front. First things first, Recaro seats, specially made here for the Fiesta ST. Pretty comfortable and very snug. These are pretty, you know, firm side supports, both here at the bottom and here on the sides. And if you get inside, there's not much wiggle room actually. And as I told you, these, if you press them, they're pretty loud, as you should be hearing. They're pretty not that good, not that well made. So that steering wheel, nice leather steering wheel, pretty big actually for a small hot hatch like that. But all in all, good grip, and you know, good with the hands. Very nice. Then we have the infotainment system, which is, you know, the functionalities work and everything, but the main problem that the owner has with this infotainment system is that it's pretty slow, especially with the navigational system. If you search for a location and stuff like that, that's why he mostly uses Google Maps on his smartphone and stuff like that. So that's, you know, a bummer that that's not really up to par with everything else in this car. The sound system, Bang & Olufsen, B&O, is really good, especially with the subwoofer that I showed you in the back. It's really nice. That's a really good quality of sound, and the bass, if you turn it up in here, sounds really, really great. So that's, as I understand, not standard, but if you have the money and want to buy one with this higher spec, which I guess wouldn't cost that much more, but yeah, it's really worth the money. One thing to add to all of that is the footrest here at the bottom. It's made out of plastic and not out of fancy material like aluminium or anything like that. So that's a minus point in the eyes of the owner. Yeah, it shakes a little bit if you step on it. So yeah, a little bit low quality over there. One thing also that he would like to have in this car, but it's not there, is some kinds of gauges, you know, some performance gauges like oil temperature, oil pressure, water temperature. Okay, water temperature is here, but you know, this kind of stuff, and G-forces, I think, also. You know, nowhere here, nowhere there. You can't really show it. Have it shown to you here anywhere. So that's a point that he's not all that pleased with. So yeah, that's a little minus if you care about stuff like that, if you want to have stuff, information like that displayed to you. All right, let's go for a drive. So, three cylinder, very nice sound, of course. That's just normal mode, but we will soon hear it also in sport, which is this button right here. So I press it once, press it again, now it's in sport. Now the valves open and we have a lot more sound. Very nice. All right, so snappy 6-speed gearbox. Let's keep it moving. So steering ratio is very short. This is a 360 degrees in every direction. So 720 degrees in total, which makes it very responsive. Very nice to drive. You don't have to move the steering wheel around very much, which is always good. Not very race car-y. Race car-ish, I guess. It's a more appropriate term. And yeah, 6-speed manual transmission, as I said, very snappy, pretty short gearing. It's creaking a little bit with the leather around it, but I guess it's not that bad. And reverse gear is up top, pull it up top and put it into first gear. So third gear, 3000 RPM, flooring it. Very nice, very responsive. You know, you don't have to wait a long time for the turbo to kick in, for the power to spool up. It's really nice and responsive. You know, the only downside to that is, of course, because the turbo is a little bit smaller to make that happen. You have, you could say, a little bit of lack of power up top. But I think in this weight class, in this class of car, having a responsive engine in lower RPM is more important than top-end speed, because you most likely be using this on winding roads and maybe on track days, you know, where accelerating out of tighter corners and stuff like that is more important for the performance of the car, for the appeal. Now, this car has a solid rear axle, which means that if you go quick on tighter turns, the rear of the car, one of the wheels, if you're going to the right, it's going to be the left side. If you're going to the left, it's going to be the right side. The rear wheel, according to the side you're turning, will, if you're going fast enough, leave the ground. So your four-wheeled car will become a three-wheeled car, which is, as far as I know, a setting point of the Fiesta. That's what the Fiesta ST is all about, you know, lifting a wheel mid-corner because of the solid rear axle. And together with the lightweight and the snappy steering, it's you're really connected to the road with this car, because also of the relatively firm suspension. It's pretty firm. It's not, doesn't have adaptive dampers, so putting it into sport or into track mode doesn't affect how the way the dampers or the springs work, but the way this is set up, it's pretty nice actually. So Now let's take a look what this little 1.5 liter three-cylinder can do on the Autobahn. So we're on third gear, 70 kilometers per hour. Basically here. Very nice. Pulls through, even though this is just 200 kilometers per hour, you know. Very nice power band, very smooth. Really nothing to complain about. One thing that this car has is a little light there in the screen right here. If I shift down into fourth, see if you get clearance. Floor it. There was a little sign that showed ST, which means you have the green light to flat shift or to power shift, which means that you can shift gears, but you can stay in throttle to reduce, you know, turbo lag and all that stuff. So you can just stay on throttle 100%. And clutch in, next gear, clutch out. That's what the little ST light down there, if you're reaching red light somewhere near there, means. Yeah, other than that, this thing consumes about 7 liters per 100 kilometers, according to the owner. The way the owner drives, and that's pretty good, you know. That's combined everything, city driving, autobahn driving, B-road driving and stuff like that. If you want to really really be cautious with your driving, because you know there's not much fuel left, like in this scenario we don't have that much fuel left, that's where we're a little cautious right now. Also there's construction sites and all that. You can drive it pretty much underneath 6 liters per 100 kilometers, because this is a 3 liter, 1.5 liter, it's a Ford EcoBoost. Yeah, shows me that it's low on fuel right now. It's a 3 liter three-cylinder EcoBoost motor from Ford, so it's of course designed also not just to put out horsepower but to be efficient. And it has also a cylinder deactivation for fuel efficiency. That's a nice 370Z. But yeah, overall, there's nothing to complain about here. Very, very good. Very solid car. A lot of fun. So yeah, that's pretty much it with this video, with this review of the Ford Fiesta ST Mark 8. If you have any questions about this car, feel free to drop them down in the comments below. I will try and answer them. And yeah, I hope you enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye.